This is a very special day, and again, I want to thank each of you for being here. We have students here, we have teachers here, we have faculty here, we have community leaders, citizens who are interested in the topic here. You're all very welcome, and I think you're going to be pleased with the program today. I think your mind will be challenged, your heart will be lifted, and we will be informed. And hopefully you will enjoy also the materials that have been provided for you. Again, Dr. Carter, thank you for your support of that as well. It's a great day to be here at Lincoln Memorial University, and I'm so pleased that Dr. Carter's nephew, Dr. Charles Moyers, is going to introduce our speaker.
Our speaker has quite a personal story to tell, and it's very inspiring to all who hear it. Dr. Ming Wang is a graduate of both Harvard and MIT. He graduated with a PhD in laser physics from MIT, and graduated with his magna cum laude with his MD degree from Harvard. He's one of the few cataract and LASIK surgeons in the world who has a PhD in laser physics. He's performed over 55,000 procedures, and 4,000 of those were on doctors, or other doctors, of course not himself. But that kind of tells you what his peers think of his ability, doesn't it? Dr. Wang has published 7 textbooks. He holds several U.S. patents, and he performed the world's first LASIK artificial corneal implantation. He's established 2 501c3 nonprofit organizations too. One is the Wang Foundation for Christian Outreach to China. And they distribute Bibles to the Chinese. The second foundation is the Wang Foundation for Sight Restoration. They have treated and helped over people from 40 states and 55 foreign countries. He also performed the first laser, all the sight restoration surgeries are done free of charge. So that's quite something to say. It's quite expensive because all these patients are very seriously ill with sight problems. Also, Dr. Wang is quite an accomplished musician on the Chinese violin. In addition to that, he's a champion ballroom dancer. So he's quite varied in his skills. He will present a talk and music presentation called "The World Is What You Make of It." Let's give a good East Tennessee welcome to Dr. Ming Wang.
Thank you for the opportunity to be with you all this morning. I'd like to thank Charlie and for initiating this arrangement and for me to make a trip to this beautiful campus at LMU, and for Joyce Bunch and other of my patients. And also to Dean Claiborne for invitation, to Dr. Carter for sponsoring this wonderful educational opportunity. I actually have one of my current students, a medical student from LMU here. He's doing a 2-month research rotation in our clinic. And so we have association with this beautiful university. I came to appreciate what Charlie and Joyce gone through every time they come to the clinic to see us, because last night I drove quite a few hours. But Charlie joked this morning, he said, well, when we go the other way, it's shorter. But I know it's the same distance, but I appreciate it, the opportunity to be with you all and this morning. Today, I want to share with you all today about a personal story. You know, living in this country, in America, we often do not appreciate what we have. So today, my story will take you back in time and take you to another place on this planet, in this case, China. And to travel with me, so to some time back, let us all experience a little bit about the lack of freedom, lack of choice, the suffering, and the longing of people that still very much desire the same things that are still not available in so much parts of the world today. By experiencing this morning a little bit about the agony and pain of not having freedom will help us today in America and will remind us how precious our freedom today is, truly is. So that's my main goal this morning, is to share with you my personal story experience and to let us realize one more time how precious freedom is. So the title of my talk is, Life is What You Make of It. You know, people who appreciate sight the most are those who are blind. People who appreciate freedom the most are those who don't have freedom. And in my case, I have suffered as a teenager in a situation where there was no freedom. And I came to truly appreciate the value of freedom. And this is Great Wall of China, built 2,000 years ago. The first emperor of China mobilized a third of the nation and to build this Great Wall. If you take all the bricks of Great Wall that connect them, you can go to the moon and back 7 times. And such a great engineering achievement was done completely by hand over 2,000 years ago. And this map of China, about the size of the United States, 4 times the population, and 1/10 of the inhabitable lands. So it's 40 times population density. Forbidden City, built for one man, the emperor, in the middle of Beijing. I grew up in China from a family of teachers. My father and mother, my brother, photoed here, that they were both teachers, professors teaching in a university, medical university. And they instilled in me and my brother, in the early days, the value of education. And it was so much so that education was everything. Every time you go to a Chinese restaurant, you open a little fortune cookie, and there was a little wise saying, right? Well, I'll tell you a story. I came to this country many years ago, and the second day I arrived, a friend of mine, you know, who met me, said, okay, you came from China, we'll bring you to a Chinese restaurant. So walk in the Chinese restaurant, and, you know, after the meal, they give this fortune cookies. I looked at it and said, what's this? He goes, aren't you from China? I said, yeah, but I've never seen one of those. It was the fortune cookie actually was an invention by an entrepreneur near Atlanta, Georgia. But my friend said, well, this is an ancient Chinese tradition. He said, okay, all right. I opened the fortune cookie, I saw a little piece of paper. And I said, Confucius wrote this. And I go, well, I didn't know Confucius knew English. So Chinese culture is very much cornerstoned by Confucius ideology and philosophy. And Confucius teaching is much more than the little wise saying, or presumably he wrote inside the fortune cookie. Confucius teaching is the cornerstone of Eastern teaching, which consists of three pillars. Everybody know about these three pillars in Eastern, because Confucianism effect upon, the world's most dominant religion in terms of number of people is Christianity. And 1.4 billion. You know the second largest 1 billion is Islam. The third is really not a religion, but it's a teaching, a philosophy, philosophical teaching, Confucianism, which is about 700 million. And then you follow by Buddhism. And Catholic teaching is comparable, actually, to Islamic teaching. But Christianity is 1.4 billion. So Confucianism has significant influence in China and Far East countries. Confucianism consists of three pillars. Respect your teacher, respect your parents, because they have been there, they have done that, they have suffered, they have more wisdom. In Chinese philosophy, they're saying that an older person, a seniority is the very reason to be respected. If someone, by mere fact that he or she is older than you, you should respect. Why? Because he or she has experienced life longer. And there's a saying says that an older person, the length of bridges that he or she has walked through is longer than the roads that you have traveled. So respect for teacher, respect for parents, and third, respect for yourself. Meaning whatever you do, even if you make a bottle, if you label this, you made it, is a pride as a human being. You make something, you make the best it can be. Because that's ultimate respect for yourself. Whatever the work you're engaged in, make the best it can be. So my whole family, my parents instilled in me as when we were young, Confucianism teaching. Education is everything. Respect your teacher. So growing up, I knew that I need to go to school, go to high school, college, and education is the single most important thing. My father's father was a traditional Chinese medical doctor, and his father served in Qing Dynasty, the emperor, also a traditional Chinese medical doctor. So it was in a family that emphasized everything about education when a disaster happened. Disaster. 1966. The communist government decided the best way to keep on governing is to actually destroy the lives of young people. Because they felt that their dictatorship will be threatened. Oh, by the way, you don't have to make any notes. I will send those PowerPoint to you through email if you ask me. I'll be happy to. So the communist government decided the best way to keep on governing is to destroy the lives, destroy the educational process of its young people. How they did it? They actually started a deportational program. 1966 deported every single junior high and senior high graduate to the poorest part of the country and condemned them a lifetime of poverty and hard labor. If any of those youngsters dared to escape back to the city, they could be jailed or killed. I mean, come to think about it, isn't it amazing? Such a big country like China, the dictator could have such a power. They just destroyed the whole nation. They shut it down all colleges. They shut down all colleges and deported all the youth. it destroyed the future of 20 million people. So 1974, I was 14 years old, and I finished my junior high. I was a straight student, and government came down to my parents' house and Ming, he is to be deported. Once you're deported, you'll be working in the fields, just like a concentration camp, for the rest of your life, earning $1 or $2 a month. Abject poverty. And I told my parents, I said, Dad, I'm a stray student, I never got a B. Why couldn't I go to senior high and college? No, government said, no, you are due to be deported. I mean, just think about it. At age 14, a teenager would be looking at life of possibility and excitement. And I was thrown, like millions of others, to the bottom of the society. And it turns out that one way to escape deportation is to have a music talent. Because communist government still have propaganda troops. They have song dance troops. So if you could play an instrument, you can dance, you might be able to allow to stay in the city exempt from deportation. So I remember one day, Dad came home and said, Ming, come over here. I got something else for you to do. I said, Dad, what can I do? I will be deported. He said, no, let's try to fight it. He gave me this Chinese violin. It's a music instrument with a pole, with a soundbox covered with snake skin. And there's two strings, the bow sits in between the two strings. It's a very simple instrument. I tested, I said, I can only strike one string at any one time because the bow sits in between the two strings. Rather than like violin sits on top, you can strike two. So I said, it couldn't even produce harmony, right? You can only make one note at any one time. And I don't want to play this. I want to go to senior high school. I want to go to college. And I said, this is the only way to avoid deportation. So I picked this instrument up to learn, not for love of music, but for sheer need to survive. And I remember days and nights that winter time, very cold, and I was supposed to play this instrument every day, practice, because I knew that was my only way out to avoid deportation, a lifetime of poverty. And it was very cold weather. I remember every day I have to start with a day with practice, each two strings, four fingers. Each finger, 5 minutes. So by the time I finish warming up practice, it will be 40 minutes, since two strings and four fingers each. In the cold weather, my fingers are frozen or frostbite. And I did not understand at age 14 why I couldn't go to school. I had to play an instrument. And this instrument is a beautiful instrument, but it has this, the sound is gentle and has a touch of melancholy. And I found that I picked up a piece written by this blind artist. His name's Abin, A-B-I-N. He was a blind artist, composed a piece called Two Springs Reflecting the Moon, depicting the scene that at night you walk out in the middle of the night, the moon shining down, two springs converging. Beautiful scene. It's one of the most beautiful pieces in Chinese music repertoire, not because it's natural beauty that it depicts, but it was an imagined beauty because the composer was blind. He was imagining how beautiful it could have been if he could see that. So the song filled with longing, unfulfilled need and desire and melancholy. So at age 14, I should be, like every other teenager, looking for life of possibilities and excitement. I was thrown at the bottom of the society, like millions of others, subject to deportation. And my sad feeling was resonating with this composer's music. Years later, I realized why I was playing his piece every day, feeling so sad because he could not see physically as a blind person. When he composed the piece, I could not see anything mentally in my future. It was funny that because playing music and trying to join the propaganda song and dance troupe by communist government as a way to escape deportation to countryside and poorest part of China. So since that was one way to avoid deportation, there was this suddenly found interest in music by tens of thousands of young people in China. So everybody picked some instrument and started playing, piano and violin. It didn't take long for the government to realize that all these young people were learning music with an ulterior motive. So I couldn't even study music and trying to escape deportation that way. So I told my parents, I said, Dad, Mom, wouldn't work. I practiced so hard, my little Chinese violin, erhu, E-R-H-U, but I would not be allowed because government just decreed it. No, you cannot stop, everybody stop learning music. So then my daddy said, well, they have song and dance troupe, so they have dancers. So I said, okay, let me learn dance. So at age 15, I started learning dancing. And these are, I suggested two readings for this Constitutional Day today. One is Mao's Last Dancer. It is actually made into a major motion picture. And those youngsters, they, in the Cultural Revolution, were all forcefully recruited into Mao's Red Guards. They were doing the dance, loyalty to the communist government with little red book, and they were prosecuting teachers and professors in universities. And the story of Mao's dancer in this book talk about this young man who came to America, escaping Cultural Revolution. And he actually was a very talented dancer, and he became the principal dancer of Houston Ballet. And his adaptation to life in America, the clashes of cultural values, and the nightmare of these folks back home suffering through Cultural Revolution. So that's the essence of Mao's Last Dancer. So I was a little dancer also at age 15. But no, communist government said, no, you can't even learn dance. Because they didn't realize that all the people you're learning dancing was trying to simply avoid deportation. So at that time, I have to give up dancing. So I have to be subject to deportation again. I met a young man. I was 15 and he was about 16, 17. And his father, who was like the Arthur Miller of China, wrote a play, very famous writer, wrote a play about historical play. The communist government decided there was a play that implying against communist government. So his father was just killed for writing that play. So young man, Tian Ma is his name, was very sad and distraught. And I met him, and I was sad too because I tried everything. It looks like I could not escape deportation. So he and I got together, and he is very talented in writing, and I taught myself music composition. So he wrote poems, and I composed songs, music for his poems. And we collaborated. We submit many of our work because we're trying to make ourselves little writers and composers. To no avail, none of our work will be accepted. Years later, looking back, I realized many of the songs that we created together, we were lucky we didn't get arrested because all of them were asking for freedom, for the opportunity to go to school. I remember one song that he wrote. I remember this is a 16, 17-year-old teenager. This reflects his mood. The song is entitled A Prisoner's Song. And his words were, at the foot of the mountain, there's my hometown. There's no water, no sunlight. And I was 1 or 2 years of junior, so I taught myself music composition and I composed music for that song, A prisoner's son. And decades later, I still remember what I wrote music at that time. Listen, I would just sing the beginning part. You get a sense of the mood and the mind of not just me, but millions of other Chinese youths. So I wrote this when I was 15 or 14. So go, do re mi, re do re mi, la si do, si la mi. You could sense the mood, emotion, and state of mind of teenager who should be looking at life of possibility and excitement was so sad. A prisoner's song. And then I couldn't even compose music because none of the publisher would take our work. So I came home. I said, Dad, I go to Kaidu. I will be deported. My father and mother told me that, well, maybe Ming, since we were teachers, their universities was one of the few, was still open. So they say, we will hide you out. We will smuggle you into medical school. So they actually practically bribed to all these teachers, say, hey, we're going to stick our son, 16-year-old, back there. Just don't report to the authority. So all the teachers, which is all their friends, right, fellow professors and teachers, they all still continue teaching, but they just keep one eye open, one eye closed, basically pretending they didn't see me. So at age 15, I was thrown smuggled into secretly into the medical school to study medicine. And I remember asking my daddy, I said, why should I be studying? I couldn't even allow to go to senior high, much less college or medical school. I would never be allowed to be a doctor. Why should I be studying? Dad said, you study here because you can hide it out from the government side, so they will not deport you. Also, he said, you're going to learn something. Just remember, son, knowledge will be good. Knowledge will always be useful. Then, as I was studying, I was a good son, listened to my parents, I studied. I had no idea what I should be studying because I was not allowed to become a doctor. The government then discovered Ming was hiding in medical school, and they threatened my parents that their jobs if I was not taken out. So I tried music, instrument, dance, music composition, even secretly studied medicine for the sake of knowledge itself. I was not allowed. So at the end, I told my parents, I said, I will be deported. And 1976, 10 years into Cultural Revolution, after 20 million young people's lives were destroyed. 1976, the dictator died. China realized what a tragic mistake it made upon itself by having destroyed the future of 20 million people. They said, wow, gosh, we destroyed a generation. Then they reopened all colleges which had been shut down for 10 years. So I remember Dad came home one day. He said, Ming, come over here. I said, Dad, I'm not coming over here. Whatever you want me to do, never succeeded. I tried everything you want me to. He said, Ming, come over here. This time is different. I came over there. He showed me a corner of a newspaper in the corner. It said, dictator just died. Colleges that which have been all shut down for 10 years may be reopened. He said, you may be able to go to college. It was unbelievable to me. Remember, I grew up in a family where education was everything. Confucianism, teaching, scholarship, and my future was shut down. Never be able to continue my education. It was a devastating blow during Cultural Revolution. And I thought, I'm done. I will never have a future. Now to be able to present this opportunity again. And I said, Dad, I forgot everything. I finished my ninth and, you know. He said, no problem. You start tomorrow. I said, study ninth, maybe review my ninth grade. He said, no, you jump ahead to 12th. said, wait a minute, Daddy. The last 2.5 years I've been doing everything except proper studying. I've been playing my Chinese violin and dancing and learning music composition, even secretly, illegally studying medicine. But I didn't do what I was supposed to as a senior high, you know, 10th, 11th grade. I didn't. So how can I jump ahead? He said, you got to jump ahead tomorrow to 12th. I said, why? He said, only 12th graduating class could go to the college entrance examination. I said, what percentage of the 12th grade got to get in this year? He said, 1 or 2%. I said, why so slow? He said, there were 10 times the applicants that year. Because all the 10 years of backlog students who were in there when they finished junior high, senior high, they were deported. All of them now, college is reopened now, they're all trying to come back to participate in the college entrance examination that's in 1976. So we have 10 times more applicants. I said, Dad, when is going to be the college entrance examination? He said, 2 months. 2 or 3 months. I said, wait. I finished my 9th 2.5 years ago. I forgot everything. I didn't study senior high. I did everything except proper studying, playing my instrument and all that. Now you want me to jump ahead to 12th grade tomorrow and trying to participate in a college examination for the with other 12th graders and try to place myself in 1 or 2%. I said, you're crazy. And Dad said, no, you got to do it. So ladies and gentlemen, let me ask you a question. Why my parents who love me so much want to subject me to such a cruel treatment? I almost kill myself trying to jump ahead in 2 months' time, entire senior 3 year senior high school content, and trying to compete with the 12th grade graduating class trying to get into college, rather than allowing me to sequentially study 9th and 11th, no, 10th and 11th, and participate in college examination 3 years later. Why? Why do they want to do such an inhumane thing to me? Light at the tunnel. Yes. But why didn't let me take my time rather than force me in 2 months' time? No, second chance, that's right. In fact, the very difficulty of some of us to be able to answer this question is the very point of my little story today. In this country, we take freedom and choice for granted. In China, in a country without freedom, my parents did not take for granted. For people who don't have freedom and choice, when freedom and choice came, just briefly, they capture it, they grasp it with all that they might. My dad said that, Ming, communist government just shut down college entrance examination for 10 years, right? Now they reopen. Who is to say they might just shut down for another 10 years next year? There's no guarantee of freedom and choice. It's dictatorship. So it could very well be that either you participate in the college entrance examination this year, or you may never ever be able to. So I said, Dad, how am I going to do it? He said, we're going to help you. So he went to, he approached many teachers, chemistry teacher, biology teacher, the senior high teacher. He said, would you come to our house, tutor our 17-year-old son, and in exchange, he's a family doctor. And he said, I will provide medical care for your family free of charge. So one day, all these teachers descended at my parents' house. Chemistry, physics, biology, everybody's ready to go. And I got so stressed out. I only 2 months. And they drove me 18 hours a day, 15 to 18 hours a day. And I got lucky because this was one time. If you don't have freedom of choice, when freedom of choice comes, you hold on to it with dear life. So millions of others competed that year, 1976. Because everybody realized it was a once-in-a-lifetime. And I was lucky to get into college that year. But once I got in college, I did not want anything to do with China. I had enough. Suffered through dictatorship and lack of freedom and choice. So I wanted to come to America, but I have no money. And I know America's land of freedom. So one day in college that I heard that there was a visiting American professor who was going to visit us. So I got my little plan to come to America. The night before this American professor's visit, I pulled out the English textbook and I studied very hard. I got my little plan to come to America. And next day, it was a classroom like this, a few hundred Chinese students. And this professor walked in. He's tall, blue-eyed, you know, tall nose. That's why I remember him. And I still remember his name, James McNesby, professor. He walked in, he gave a lecture. And really, none of us really understood what he was saying because our English was so poor and very limited. But we all good students listened. At the end of his lecture, he goes, "Any questions?" And all the Chinese students were very obedient, very quiet. My hand was very high. And he said, "Yes." And I stood up. Remember, I've got my little plan to come to America. So I asked him a question that I spent all night in preparing to ask. So this is what happened, unexpectedly. He had no idea what I was asking, because my English is so poor. So he stood there and he would start saying things. I had no idea what he was saying. Then I realized that, oops, I practiced all night how to ask a question. I forgot how to practice to listen to possible answers to my question. So I have no idea what he was saying. So all I could do is keep on standing there asking the same question over and over. And all the other Chinese students were sitting there saying, "Ming, what are you gobbling about? You know, what are you talking to me?" Everybody, their English is just as poor as me, and so no idea what I was asking. And but I realized, but I have no choice. I'm stuck on it. I'm gonna need to. This is my plan. This is my life. Once a lifetime. I need to go to America. So I need to impress this professor, right? So I kept on asking the same question over and over, 9, 10 times. Finally, the professor realized that, oh, this youngster, he was really not impressed by my English or lack of, but he was impressed by my persistence in asking the same question over and over. I have no idea what he was asking. Now, years later, I realized why he didn't understand, even though I thought I practiced my question pretty well the night before, because yes, I did pull out English textbook to study, all right, to prepare to ask this question, but I happened to pull out the night before a British English textbook, not an American one. So the way the question was phrased was in a British way. I still remember this question today. The question was, "What is the academic load of your school?" Now, in Great Britain, apparently academic load has specific meaning. It means what's the number of credits an undergraduate student supposed to have to graduate from with a bachelor's degree. But this American professor, academic load doesn't have that specific meaning. So he must be saying something like, "What do you mean, academic load?" Now, of course, I have no idea what he was saying, so I kept on repeating the same question. So I just happened to pull out the wrong English textbook. But he was impressed nonetheless. The student will keep on asking the same question over and over, have no clue what he was saying. But he was really impressed by my persistence and tenaciousness. So just before Professor James McNesby walked off the podium, he goes, "That youngster, I want to see him in America." So 1982, with $50 borrowed from him and with enough money borrowed from relatives for one-way airplane ticket, I was dropped off at National Airport, Washington, D.C., with $50, a Chinese-English dictionary, and with a big American dream in my heart. And sometimes, you know, friends ask, "Why you work so hard?" I said, "America is the nation who allowed me to go to school and study. I have the opportunity of going to some of the good schools in this country. And my work over the years, whether it's medical charity, art, music, dance, all were inspired by the appreciation of freedom. And I want to tell you a little bit about my current work, for example, just give you a sense of, and as well as a little education about what's the current state of ophthalmology. Charlie and Joyce Bunch both were my patients and had surgeries. Now, this is the structure of the eye. I studied that in medical school that, you know, cornea is where nearsightedness, farsightedness, astigmatism, and the lens is where cataract is formed. So today, for vision surgery, we, based on age, you're 18 or older, LASIK surgery, 40 older, forever young surgery, and 60 older, cataract surgery. And the technology, so for example, LASIK surgery, the older is blade. Now we no longer use a blade or laser. And we're currently the only center in Tennessee offering 3D, and 3D is the digital. We had the opportunity to perform the first 3D LASIK. And I want to show you a little video, give you a sense of 3D LASIK today, the status of the technology.
Well, it's been 20 years since eye surgeons first started performing LASIK, a procedure that corrects nearsightedness, farsightedness, and astigmatism. In those two decades, the technology that's been used for LASIK hasn't changed much until now. Dr. Ming Wang is the first and only surgeon in Tennessee offering a new 3D LASIK technology. Dr. Wang, it's nice to have you with us today.
Good to see you again, Meryl.
You too. Well, let's talk about 3D LASIK. How is that different from the traditional LASIK technology?
You know, Meryl, that what drives the modern technology in 21st century is the concept called digitalization. Mm-hmm. Digitalization lies behind all technology we see with computers, with automations and everything. So in order to improve the precision and accuracy of medical surgery procedures such as LASIK surgery, we are now moving from analog, the older technology, to digital. That is, during LASIK surgery, the surgeon will have a high-definition microsurgical system mounted on the side, capture the image of the eye real-time during surgery, and digitally amplify 100 times bigger. So instead of analog work underneath the microscope with eyeballs very small, the image of the eyeball is digitally enhanced 100 times larger. And then you can computer digitally control the laser beam position. You can import digitally the preoperative corneal map. So basically it's a digital technology applied to LASIK surgery.
So what's the benefit for patients?
Mainly is precision and safety. Because, you know, when you come to eye surgery, the main concern people have is that I want to have vision surgery, but I want to have it done safely, precisely. I want to have the best quality vision. And quality vision comes from being precise, being more accurate with the digital technology rather than the analog older technology. So it's better vision and more precise and safer.
A lot of folks, when they're considering LASIK surgery, worry about whether or not it's going to hurt. Is it painful?
And the procedure is largely painless. And basically, we numb the eye very well. We use what we call all laser technology. So no blade is used. And then add on to this 3D system, 3D LASIK, we now improve the accuracy and precision of the procedure. So essentially, it's a painless procedure, rapid visual recovery, and 99% of patients return to work the very next day. We have done about 55,000 procedures, including on over 4,000 doctors. And all these doctors return to work pretty much the next day.
Let's talk about that recovery time. Can you see almost instantly afterward?
Next day. The day of procedure, a little bit blurry, you go home and resting, you know, keep eyes closed and listen to music. Mm-hmm. But next day, you have about 90% of vision right away. You can pretty much return to do most of the things you do on the very next day after 3D LASIK.
Wow. How long does it last?
The LASIK has been around for about 22 years worldwide. Mm-hmm. And so far, we found that 99% of those patients who have LASIK procedure are stable. So we expect to last the majority of our adulthood, and then later on when you get older, you have a cataract or something that's, of course, something else. And regarding 3D, we're just very excited. You know, we were the first and currently the only center in Tennessee offering this digital LASIK technology, 3D LASIK.
Is it more expensive to have a 3D LASIK procedure than a traditional LASIK?
A little bit more expensive because it has the entire 3D technology mounted on top of traditional LASIK technology. And but it's for your vision, for your sight, for the rest of your life. You know, it's really worth every penny.
All right. Thank you so much for telling us about it, Dr. Wang. We appreciate it.
You're welcome. It's good to be here again.
All right. We'll find out more online at wangvisioninstitute.com, and we will link that to our website at newschannel5.com.
A lot of people always come and ask me, you know, what's my secret to success? How do I stay happy? How do I stay sane? I say, hell, I ain't sane. Who ever said that?
Then Dolly recognized a certain ballroom dancing eye surgeon in the crowd.
Hello, Dr. Wang. How are you? I just had an appointment with him yesterday. I got the LASIK surgery. That's what turned my hair pink.
Now, Dolly's going to appear on Monday's season opener of Dancing with the Stars, where she's going to sing a song. Oh, yeah. And that reminds her, of course, of Ming Wang.
He's always tried to get me to dance. He looks at my little legs that has a muscle in the back and says, are you a dancer? I said, what are you doing looking at my legs?
Okay, back to the Hall of Fame.
So that's vintage Dolly. And so that's, I just want to give you a glimpse of what's the latest technology with vision now. And that's LASIK surgery. And this is a textbook LASIK I published a number of years ago. These are other textbooks that I've published over the years in LASIK and cataract surgery fields. These are some of the most widely used textbooks by surgeons worldwide today. And what if one is over age 40, and now we have forever young lens surgery to help baby boomers get rid of reading glasses now. And that's the latest technology and very, very exciting. And I want to show you a little video about the Forever Young Lens Surgery.
3D Forever Young Lens Surgery is a surgery that now has enabled our 40 to 65 year olds to reduce their dependence on reading glasses. As we get older, the lens inside our eyeball gets more rigid. We lose the range of vision. That's why as we get older, we have to push things further and further away to read. That's a condition called presbyopia. So presbyopia is an age-dependent loss of reading ability up close. For a long time, we have no treatment for the 40 to 65 year olds to reduce that dependence on reading glasses. 3D Forever Young Lens Surgery has enabled our 40 to 65 year olds reduce that dependence on reading glasses.
Once I found out that I thought Dr. Wang was the best person to go to, I came to the Vision Center and literally went through every machine here. So, I mean, it's just a beautiful experience to come here and be able to see well after it's done.
So 3D Forever Young Lens Surgery consists of laser lens surgery, laser astigmatism correction, and 3D technology for surgery, and intraoperative wavefront smart eye surgery technology. So the 3D Forever Young Lens Surgery is to replace the inflexible lens with a lens that can give you the range of vision again. So now with the 3D Forever Young Lens Surgery, when light comes to the eye of a patient with presbyopia, they're able to read things up close once again, restoring their accommodative function.
I'm really wonderful I had the surgery. I can't express enough how happy I am with it. I am working now, and I can read the blueprints, and just it's just better all the way around.
3D Forever Young Lens Surgery has enabled our 40 to 65 year olds to reduce their dependence on glasses or bifocals. We are proud to be the first center and only center in Tennessee that offers 3D Forever Young Lens Surgery, which consists of laser lens surgery, 3D technology, and intraoperative wavefront smart eye orange technology.
His signature cowboy hat and dark sunglasses do more than make Charlie Daniels look cool. They protect his eyes. For years now, the Mount Juliet native and country music legend has been losing his eyesight to cataracts. But today, he's among the first group of patients in Tennessee to undergo a revolutionary new procedure called smart eye surgery to have his sight restored.
Well, now the devil went down to Georgia and he's looking for a soul to steal.
Country legend Charlie Daniels is used to performing in the glare of bright lights. In recent years, the 75-year-old entertainer has been losing his sight to cataracts. Today, he's one of the first patients in Middle Tennessee to undergo a revolutionary new procedure called smart eye surgery.
I'm going to get straightened out here and be able to see without glasses for the first time in 68 years.
Dr. Ming Wang is the first cataract surgeon in the state to introduce the smart eye surgery technology. Instead of waiting weeks, this new technique allows a surgeon to customize treatment as needed immediately after the cataract has been removed.
That we can actually do the mid-flight adjustment on the operating table before surgery is finished to test drive, to see how well this particular patient's body, in this case, Ms. Daniel's eye, is reacting to the lens implanted.
Charlie had surgery on his left eye 2 days ago.
Well, it's still a little fuzzy, and I see some halos, but that's to be expected.
He had surgery on the right eye Thursday morning. Smart Eye technology lets Dr. Wang analyze Charlie's vision and make precise adjustments during the procedure, giving Charlie a faster recovery time.
I'm just looking forward to not having to reach over and pat around on the table for glasses when I get up in the morning to see where I'm going.
Now, Dr. Wang tells us that Charlie's home tonight and doing great, and Charlie says he now has two smart eyes. For more on smart eye surgery and to see our complete interview with Charlie, go to our website at WKRN.com.
So that's a little glimpse of current state of medical technology for eye surgery. 3D LASIK for young people, 3D forever young lens surgery for baby boomers, get rid of reading glasses, and laser cataract surgery for those of us who are over age 60. As I was studying medicine at Harvard, and something else happened in my life, that as I was studying the structure of human eyes, I found that the very complexity of the eye, I could not understand how such a complicated structure such as human eye with ganglion cells, retinal cells, photoreceptors could randomly evolve in a short period of time where universe is purported to have existed, 13 billion years. And it would have taken trillions and trillions of years. So interestingly, because I was grew up in with a scientist background, that the whole family was about science and scholarship and studying, then I realized that more study I've done, the more unknown questions I have. So I was in crisis because a student gung-ho on science, and I found science is not offering what I was looking for. Could not answer questions such as the sudden change at the beginning of the universe and the complexity of human body that just unfathomable it could have evolved out of random. And right at the time that a professor who saw this opportunity in me at Harvard or all places, he, pediatric professor, because I respect him, medical knowledge. So he took me out for lunch one day. And he said, "Ming, what's across the street?" I said, "That's a car." He said, "What's the difference between a car and human brain?" "Oh," I said, "human brain is a lot more complicated." He said, "Okay. Can you imagine a pile of random piece of metal assemble itself into a car?" I said, "Oh, no way." He said, "How about human brain?" Right then and there, he opened a window in my life and let me open my mind to the possibility of faith, of intelligent design, of a purpose, a deeper purpose in life. So I gradually learned that perhaps science and faith both are needed for our lives, but both are the opposite side of the same coin, life. Science is about what things are. Faith is about why things are. And I became a believer and I pursued the Christian faith and learning about purpose of life, the deeper meaning of life. And then another problem occurred. That is, as we study
science, we have increasingly realized that many human diseases are a result of aging. Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's, macular degeneration, disease of age. You know what's the best treatment for disease of age? It's young tissue, fetal tissue, embryonic tissue. In fact, a baby who has spinal cord deformation before birth, if you can detect that through ultrasound, and you can actually take the baby out of the mother's womb, uterus, do the spinal repair, and put the baby back in the uterus and deliver the baby full term. And the magical thing is, when you see this baby delivered, there's no scar, all tissue regenerated. We all have the ability to regenerate before birth. The moment we're born, we lose that. We took on, from regeneration before birth, take on a process called fibrosis, scarring. And it's interesting to speculate why adults scar and babies don't. The reason, one of the reasons is perhaps in adult harsh world, dirty, cold, if you cut yourself, what's your priority? You got to heal quickly to prevent infection and bleeding. And the price you pay for the speed of healing is disorganization or scarring. But if the same injury occurred in the baby's, in mother's uterus womb, when baby got a little cut, there's no hurry. In a sterile amniotic fluid environment, baby can just take time to regenerate. So here's the question. Knowing human diseases are diseases of aging, macular degeneration, Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's, diabetes, and all these diseases of aging, we need to use young tissue. We'd love to know how the little baby can heal, how the baby can regenerate without scarring. But here's the problem. How can you study the baby without touching the baby? So, science and faith, are they friends or foes? This is one of the most important questions facing our society in the 21st century. What do you do? Do we conduct stem cell fetal tissue research? Hurting the baby for the sake of helping adults? Or do we don't do research? If we don't do research, then we stop. Because research is what carries our lives forward, improving quality of lives. Today, our life has been transformed in every aspect. iPads, iPhone. I mean, science and technology has transformed every facet of our lives. If we stop research, we're stopping improving quality of lives. Is that what God wants us to do? Stop improving? If you say yes, how can you justify hurting the baby? If you say no, what if your grandma suffered macular degeneration and Alzheimer's? You look at the grandma, you're not going to be able to help grandma. So, what would you do? Yes or no to stem cell fetal tissue research? And here I want to share with you a little video of my personal struggle and journey in this area, trying to figure out what is it God wants us to do. When we know young tissue is going to help treat the most important human category of human disease due to aging.
Hello, I'm Dr. Ming Wang, and I'm here to tell a story. And through the story, I want to ask one of the life's greatest questions. Are faith and science friends or foes? Sixteen years ago, we were conducting corneal wound healing research and found that in contrast to an adult eye, which scars after injury, resulting in the loss of sight, a fetus can actually heal without scar. Understanding how a fetus can heal without scar offered the intriguing opportunity to help us figure out how an adult eye can also heal without scar, therefore preserving sight. But here, science and faith clashes with each other. Faith dictates that we should leave the embryo and the fetus alone and should not conduct such research. In contrast, science says we should. If we follow our faith and do not conduct such research, then how can we face the patients who are suffering from illnesses for which stem cell and fetal wound healing research may present the only hope for treatment? As an eye doctor, I really want to help my patients restore their sight. But I was also struggling with my moral conscience and faith. How can I take life away from an unborn child? We agonized over this dilemma, to the point that we were at our wits' end, and I nearly gave up on the whole fetal wound healing research project. There just seems to be no solution at all. I needed to know that it was going to be a long and arduous journey, that the right solution is often the most difficult one. We began looking at this problem from different angles and perspectives and stumbled upon the amniotic sac, a casing which holds the baby before the baby is born and is disposed of after the child is born. We ask ourselves the question, is it possible the amniotic membrane may in fact contain the ingredient of scarless fetal wound healing process? So when this membrane is transplanted onto an adult eye, that it can create a fetus-like environment and to encourage the adult eye underneath the membrane to heal without scar, just like in the fetus. Excited at this possibility, we began a series of experiments. I obtained the amniotic membrane from mothers who, after birth of their children, donated the amniotic sacs, and I transplanted this amniotic membrane onto injured eyes. We published the first paper in scientific literature that demonstrated laboratory success of reduction of corneal scar with amniotic membrane transplantation. And elucidated its molecular mechanism, why it worked. We invented amniotic membrane contact lens, obtained two US patents, and started product development. Finally, after 16 years, we succeeded.
A Nashville doctor is introducing new technology he says can do more than help patients see, it can actually hear. Dr. Min Wong says he has developed a procedure using amniotic membranes to clarify vision and reduce scar tissue.
Using amniotic membrane, we create a contact lens and we cover the eye surface, recreate a fetus-like environment to encourage the adult body to heal.
The cornea, which would not heal for over 6 months with all other kind of medications, with this it has healed completely.
Dr. Wang researched the project for 16 years before treating a patient. The amniotic sacs are donated by mothers after they give birth.
So the magical thing happened after we removed this membrane 2 weeks later. Instead of seeing, you know, for injured eyes, instead of seeing a scarred blind eye, mm-hmm. we saw clear vision eye with vision.
Wow. That's pretty amazing.
Tonight, an amazing story that reads like a medical miracle. Matt Higgins was just 4 years old when he was diagnosed with Stevens-Johnson syndrome, a severe infection that took away his sight and could have killed him. For the last 13 years, Matt has been legally blind. But yesterday, he defied the odds once again. And health reporter Terry Merriman was there to witness it all. Terry?
Demetria, Matt Higgins has spent 13 years of his life with scarred corneas, able to see only hints of light and image. Dr. Ming Wang has spent 15 years of his life researching an unborn child's ability to heal without scarring. Well, yesterday, two people who had been working toward an important goal realized miracles do happen.
A person who influenced my life in my late teens.
Matt Higgins and Dr. Ming Wang have waited 6 years for this moment.
I think this is the most amazing thing, that all the research or the work, eventually you find that actually can really make a big difference in patient's life.
You know, I've never seen his cornea this clear.
Matt was too young for reconstructive surgery on his scarred corneas when he first came to see Dr. Wang. But last week, the time was right for the final step, helping Matt's eyes heal themselves. Dr. Wang performed corneal stem cell transplants using tissue from an adult donor and an amniotic membrane transplant using tissue donated from a newborn.
And I call this type of technique tapping fountain of youth. You kind of take advantage of the youthful healing ability and use a piece of tissue, in this case amniotic membrane, which is always discarded after cesarean section, then transplant back to adult eye and heal the eye.
An unborn child has scarless fetal healing ability. This membrane converts the same healing ability to Matt's eyes.
Between science research and our faith and moral principles, there are opportunities like this. You can, you know, satisfy both. Don't have to be afraid.
Now, Matt must learn to see again, learning to feel light on his eyes. He's making great progress.
People wonder if that miracles ever happen, and they have. They do. For so long, he's been beside me, afraid to branch out on his own almost. And now that he can see, he'll probably fly the coop.
Well, maybe he's not ready for flying the coop, but Matt does want to get his learner's permit to drive as soon as the doctor says it's okay.
Amazing story. Dr. Wang has used the same technology to develop an amniotic membrane contact lens. It can be transplanted shortly after cornea trauma to prevent scarring.
Today, eye doctors throughout the world use the amniotic membrane contact lens to cover injured eyes, to reduce scar, and to restore sight. Countless number of patients have benefited from this new technology and had their sight restored. Amniotic membrane contact lens is a powerful example which shows that, in fact, faith and science can indeed work together. Through the study and use of amniotic membrane, we gained a better understanding of the scarless fetal wound healing process, which benefited adult eyes and helped restore sight. All these without touching any part of the unborn child. My name's Ming Wang, and I do believe that not only faith and science are compatible and can work together, but also it is through uniting them rather than splitting can we actually find a new, unexpected, and more powerful solutions to the problems in our lives.
I think God does want us to do research. He wants us to improve the quality of lives. And he wants us to use this amniotic membrane. So now we wait until the baby is born. And the placenta, which is always discarded, we ask the mother to donate the placenta, which is discarded anyway, to us. And we take the placenta back in laboratory, bioengineer the placenta into a contact lens, and put a placenta contact lens onto adult injured eyes so adult can heal like a baby. It's a great example of performing fetal research without touching a baby. So science and faith can work together. Sometimes it's hard, sometimes take long effort, and God said that good things will take a while. It's not going to be obvious. But we need to persist. The faith is demonstrated when things are not obvious, when things are not easy. And incidentally, if you know anyone who is going to give birth to a child and they don't mind donating the placenta, let us know. And we make arrangement. Those has to be very fresh placentas. Before they get discarded, we just salvage these placenta back after baby is delivered, and one placenta can save 100 people's eyes. So I feel that our lives will be improved, the quality of lives, and our faith gets strengthened if we, at the end of the day, we recognize that God wants us to improve our quality of lives, at the same time maintain our moral, ethical principles. And it can be done, and we need to advance both. The music instrument I played during Cultural Revolution as a teenager, the Chinese violin, erhu, to escape deportation, now became a hobby. Now with my good friend Carlos Andriga, we formed a little band called Music for Sight to raise the public awareness of the need to
help blind patients. And that's our little band, Chinese violin. And this is my, I told Charlie and Joyce and friends early, this is my music venture with Dolly Parton. She sang a country song and I played a Chinese violin and to an old country song about Civil War. It's beautiful. One of the ultimate venture, East and West. Even the dancing that I learned during the Cultural Revolution, trying to escape the deportation to join the song and dance troops, now it became a hobby as well. And utilizing the beauty of dancing to remind us how precious sight is. About 10 years ago, I got together with a bunch of doctors, eye doctors, and they said, you know, in this country, I mean, as an immigrant, I feel I have the obligation to help America, health care, and also help America remind everyone how precious freedom is through my experience of not having freedom. For health care, you know, our nation is going through significant crisis financially because we have 15% of the population have no health insurance. How do we provide care for those who cannot afford? You can have bigger government, higher taxes, but the problem with that is taken away freedom and choice. I know today is a constitutional day. We study American Constitution. We remind us the founding principles of this great nation, America. So we want to help the poor. At the same time, we don't want bigger government, higher taxes, because those things taken away the very definition of America, which is freedom. So what's the solution to care for the poor without bigger government, higher taxes, or bankrupting our nation? So I got together with many eye doctors, and 10 years ago, I said, we need to do something as eye doctors. Is it possible we can all form a team? We will donate part of our work. So this experiment started, what we call embedded care. Meaning, rather than build a freestanding inner-city clinic, the problem with freestanding inner-city clinic, which I've worked for some of those as a volunteer before, that they never run well. They're always broken down. Why? Because nobody really cares. At the same time, you think about what drives, say, a regular eye doctor or medical doctor to the hospital, what drives the quality? Especially private clinics and hospitals, private enterprise. It's a human nature, right? Only when the owner is a real interest building, he or she will do a good job. So you have public freestanding clinics serving the charity, poor patients. Nobody's interest building, so nobody cares. It's always run down, these inner city freestanding clinics. So my idea was, is it possible we can combine the two? Meaning, rather than building freestanding clinics to serve charity poor patients, which nobody really run the businesses, and how about combine the private enterprise, the need to create a good business by private ownership, we put it in embed this way. So this is what I call embedded charity care. I approached many eye doctors, 30 of them. I said, is it okay, doctor, if our foundation would do all the work, identify the charity patients, and triage to your clinic, you may see 30 patients a day, but in the middle of it, I put a few charity patients in there. You don't charge. And doctor, you don't need to go anywhere. You just see your patient, just you don't charge for a few patients. I will make sure that the charity patient is under 5%. And most of the doctors I talk to say, sure, I would do that. If I don't need to go out of my clinic, I'm busy to find these patients, and other than seeing the patient, I don't need to do anything else. I said, that's correct. And they would do it. They would donate a small portion at a time. So this experiment started 10 years ago. It's been 10 years. And today we have helped patients from over 40 states and 55 countries with all site registration surgery performed free of charge. And so I think this is the experiment that this perhaps can serve as a model system. If I think that all medical clinics can duplicate this, all medical specialties, I mean, this is what America is about. It's about being volunteers. It's about contributing to society voluntarily, all of us. Chip in what we can do, whatever we can do. So in this case, by embedding the charity care into existing private enterprise and keep a low percentage, so private enterprise still run well, everybody was able to contribute. And doctors still do what they do, seeing patients. And then those charity patients, those poor patients get the same quality of care as the other private paying patients. And all doctors have the opportunity to contribute, reduce our nation's healthcare burden to care for the poor without introducing bigger government and higher taxes, without taking away freedom and choice. So that was foundation idea, and this is a story of Kajal. She was 4.5 years old. We found her in India, Calcutta, India. She was sleeping one night, and her stepmother, she was an orphan, and she only had a stepmother, whose stepmother poured acid into her eyes. And she instantaneously got blind, Kajal. She immediately cried and the whole night and got blind. Because this crazy stepmother was trying to convert her into a blind child singer who will get more money from tourists. So Kajal was blinded, but she couldn't sing. They found that she had no talent. So Kajal was abandoned. And our foundation found her in a train station near Calcutta, India. She almost died from starvation. And we brought Kajal to this country, and the foundation did a very difficult surgery, restored limited degree of her sight. At our foundation event, we call our foundation annual event, you know, the event to raise money to help people see, we call it the eyeball. So at our event, eyeball, after the band struck Tennessee Waltz, after that, 500 people, all guns and tails. Attending eyeball is a throwback into 17th century Vienna. All guns and tails, the beauty of ballroom dancing. Few things as elegant and beautiful as classical ballroom dancing. And the whole point is enjoy the beauty, but at the same time, the beauty reminds us how precious God-given gift to us, sight, is, and how much we need to help those who have lost their gift. So Kajal actually, after the band struck, the dancing party started, and after the band struck the Tennessee Waltz, started music, Kajal was the one who started the first dance. In the middle, after her dance, I gave her a microphone. I said, Kajal, say something to the 500 big aunties and uncles in this country who love you so much. Kajal took the microphone and surprised everyone. After she came to this country, Kajal did something herself. Because in her five-year-old mind, that she was abandoned back home in India after being intentionally blinded, that she was abandoned later because they found that, you know, she couldn't sing, could not be converted to a blind child singer. In her little mind, that she was abandoned was because she could not sing. So as a five-year-old, that's all she could comprehend. So she wanted to demonstrate her worth. She's worth keeping. And so Kajal got together with few friends that she made in this country, and Kajal learned to sing. So at that moment, after her eyeball first dance, I gave her microphones. I said, Kajal, say something to all the big aunties and uncles in this room who love you so much. Kajal took the microphone, big smile, because she had a little secret. Did not tell any one of us. Kajal sang a song. And at the moment that the eyeball, that Kajal, the song that she chose herself, without telling any of us ahead of time, the title that she chose, the song that she chose was Jesus Loves Me. And I want to show you a video about eyeball dancing to show you that the beauty of dancing. And as I said, the whole point of the beauty is through the beauty. Now remember, I learned this dance during Cultural Revolution through trying to escape a deportation program in communist China. Thank you. So the, as I said, the dancing skill that I learned during Cultural Revolution as a teenager, trying to escape deportation, and now became a hobby, utilizing the dancing skill to help the medical charity and to remind us how beautiful God-given gift to us, sight, is. Because without sight, we'll not be able to appreciate dancing. And I want to show you the story of another foundation patient, and his name is Brad.
A year ago, we introduced you to a Hazelwood man blinded in an industrial accident. His world consisted of shades of light and dark. But Washington University doctors transplanted a salivary gland from under his jaw to his temple to restore moisture to his eyes. That enabled him to undergo a unique surgery that could restore his sight. Tonight in the in-depth in the Fox Files, one man's inspirational battle to see again. What lies beneath these sunglasses may be disturbing for you to look at, but imagine living this way.
I spent a long, long time, 12 years, you know, it's been a long time being blind.
I'm shining some light into Brad's right eye, and as you could see that it's very wide and scarred up.
Flaps of skin cover Brad Barnes' corneas. They were destroyed in an industrial accident. But the 43-year-old hopes a couple of hours of special surgery will change that.
You can see the light right now, right?
Yes.
Good.
It's been that way since that September night in 1994, 15 minutes before his 32nd birthday. Brad was working with molten aluminum.
The tank exploded in my face. It was 1,100 pounds of 1,550-degree molten aluminum. It hit my eyes and I was instantly blinded. It burned my corneas and my tear glands right out of my eyes.
So Brad is what we called a patient with a condition called irreversible corneal blindness, for whom all traditional technologies have failed and no longer work.
But eye surgeon Dr. Ming Wang is using new technology developed at his Vision Institute in Nashville. First, he'll use a special laser to create a pocket in the eye. In a second procedure, he'll insert an artificial cornea. Brad's wife, Jackie, is the one who heard about Dr. Wang's work. She puts it in God's hands.
We won't know unless we try, and if it's his will that he doesn't see, then he'll continue doing what he's doing.
What he's doing is working with kids and motivating people.
My brother Brad's having surgery tomorrow at 8:30 in the morning to get a cornea transplant.
He's part of the God Squad, a group that uses strongman feats to share its faith with others. He also speaks to students on behalf of the martial arts studio where he works out.
It's just a calling on my heart from God that I need to just go and give back to the community and give back to society.
The laser surgery is going well.
Perfect. We are in good shape. How are you feeling?
I'm doing okay. That's
we accomplished right. The step beautifully, and the laser pocket is beautiful.
Dr. Wang is excited about how things are going, but there is more work to be done and more waiting for Brad's wife, Jackie.
Yeah, I am really nervous. I'm just waiting, and I just want to hear it was successful. That's what I'm waiting for.
But she knows there are no guarantees.
And that's okay, too. But it would be so cool if it worked. He deserves it.
If it does work, how much sight would Brad regain?
It's not 20/20. It's to restore vision from nearly complete darkness to some degree of vision. One can take care of yourself at home.
You know, just that little bit of sight for someone that can't see, you can't imagine unless you've been there how much that little bit can do for you.
I'm gonna put a little artificial cornea.
Dr. Wang calls it burying the treasure. It's implanted and covered up.
And 3 months later, we make a little opening, and I call it uncovering of the treasure, so he will be able to see again.
Finally, Jackie got the news she had been waiting for. The surgery was more complicated than Dr. Wang anticipated. He actually located Brad's pupil that had been displaced by the blast and recentered it.
So I basically rebuilt the front part of his eye, rebuilt the whole thing. And then I was able to put my little artificial cornea in there and suture all together.
This is so cool.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. It's been a long process, you know.
I know.
For you.
I know.
So we got a good start.
A start that could give him a glimpse of the one thing he has never seen.
but wants to behold the most.
I want to see my wife's face. I want to hear her laugh the way I hear her now, and I want to see her smile.
That's because Brad has never seen Jackie's face. They were married just 2.5 years ago. Brad had the procedure on just his left eye. Dr. Wang tells me the combination of the salivary gland transplant done by Dr. Randall Paniello at Washington University and his laser artificial cornea surgery is a world's first. In 3 months, Brad will return to Nashville to have the bandages removed and hopefully see a world he hasn't seen in 12 years.
The Wang Foundation for Sight Restoration is bringing sight to the corneal blind. Established to help indigent patients cover their expenses, the foundation is giving sight to people who can't afford eye reconstructive surgeries. The foundation is a registered nonprofit 501c3 organization. The Foundation for Sight Restoration's Medical Council doctors provide free care to Foundation patients in need of experimental and novel eye reconstructive surgeries. The Foundation has received requests from 40 different states in the U.S. and 55 different countries around the world. The Foundation's purpose is to provide care for terminally blind patients where there is no available treatment with traditional technologies. The Foundation raises funds throughout the year, but holds their major event, the eyeball, in autumn. The foundation uses the contributions to pay for medical expenses for patients. No foundation funds are used to pay for professional services rendered by the Medical Council physicians. What's more, the Foundation for Sight Restoration funds new research. Foundation researchers published the first scientific paper demonstrating reduction of corneal scarring using amniotic membrane grafts. They received a U.S. patent for this invention. The world's first femtosecond laser artificial cornea implantation successfully restored vision in a 40-year-old man, the Foundation's first patient. The Foundation for Sight Restoration is bringing sight to the corneal blind.
With a Bible in hand, Brad Barnes has left a lot of what is about to happen today to a higher power.
You ready?
I'm ready.
13 years ago, Brad lost his sight in a foundry explosion. Molten aluminum burned his body and his eyes for what Brad thought would be forever.
After 15 major surgeries at several major medical centers, he was declared to be irreversibly blind.
Barnes was referred to Dr. Ming Wang's Foundation for Sight Restoration. He was the first person in the world to receive a procedure developed by Dr. Wang, a combination saliva gland transplant and laser artificial cornea implantation.
I think this is a dawn of a new era of transplantation medicine. Man-made body parts. You reduce the risk of organ transplantation rejection, which is the number one problem in organ transplantation.
Yesterday was the final surgery in a 2-year journey. Today, Brad's bandages are removed. It's unclear because of blood and swelling how much Brad might see. Dr. Wang cleans out his eye and slowly opens the lid. Supporters wait with nervous anticipation.
I see thumb up. Yeah. Thumbs up.
Yes.
I see it.
You can see my thumb?
Yes. And hang on. Don't move.
Okay, don't move.
Is this your face?
Yes.
Yeah, I see your face over there.
The most important thing Brad can now see is his wife, Jackie.
Yeah, I can see you now. Yeah.
And for the first time in nearly 13 years, Brad sees himself in a mirror.
Yeah, that's me. That's
me. Yeah. With each passing minute, Brad's eyesight gets a little better.
I'm just overwhelmed. It's very surreal, and I'm just really happy.
Brad is fascinated by things we take for granted, like a crumpled piece of tissue. But it's clear this is a life-changing day.
This is incredible. This is incredible. Man, I can't even believe this.
A moment to witness a patient going from a life of darkness to sight. Personally priceless for Dr. Wang and everyone involved.
That moment is worth all the hard work and research and sleepless nights for decades.
You know, seeing people like Brad, you remind us how precious sight is. China is going through significant economic transformation. It has been the envy of the world in the last three decades with double-digit growth annually for over 20 years. But we as human beings cannot just have enough clothes to wear in our body. We need the clothes and the food for our minds. People no longer believe in communist ideology because communism has only made people poor. What has made China better now economically is capitalism. So people discard the communist ideology and no longer believe that. They take on capitalism. But we can't just, you know, have, as I said, have clothing for our physical body. We have to have mental, moral guidance and for conduct. So Chinese people are in an unprecedented spiritual vacuum. They're looking for new moral codes of conduct. And what is the new moral ethical principle? Because communism fell on the wayside. Nobody believes in communism anymore. So this is an absolutely amazing opportunity for us Christians to bring the word of Jesus Christ to a land where 95% of people are not Christians yet. So it's a project that has the potential to recruit for God's kingdom a quarter of human population. We have newly translated Bible with Lifeway. We bring to China and get from recipient an email address. And then we electronically communicate through email. We recruit Christian brothers and sisters as pen pals. And I communicate with the budding Christians in China who got one of the Bibles to help them nurture them, fellowship with them. It's our China Bible Project. Very often I get questions, you know, friends ask me, you know, man, you work so hard, why you work so hard? And I said, you know, I work hard because from my experience of once not having the freedom. And so what lesson I've learned, and in terms of my today, my little talk, the life is what you make of it, is your parents love you. They have been there. They have suffered. They know. And your teachers love you. They labor hard to ignite in you the curiosity and drive. And respect seniority, respect knowledge and experience. And when opportunity comes in life, such as in Cultural Revolution at the end, when the dictator died, all of a sudden I could go to college again, even though it was an insurmountable task that I have to jump through 3 years in such a short period of time. When opportunity comes in life, don't let it go. Grab it. Make the best of it. And so, as I said, my little story today is about life is what we make of it. It's about appreciating the freedom and opportunity that we have. My pastor, Pastor Rice, wrote a book, God's Not Dead, on your desk, that about 2 years ago, he chronicled the lives of several individuals, and I was one of the characters in the book documenting my path from being atheist, China, and no freedom and choice, come to this country, find the freedom and choice, appreciating it, and contributing back. And also find that life is much more purposeful and much rich, much more enriched if one is open your mind to the possibility of faith, and allowing faith and science to work together rather than antagonizing, clashing with each other. This book called The Hollywood Producers' Attention about a year ago, and they made it into a movie. And it now it's in the theater now, God's Not Dead. It actually broke all expectations. It took only $1 million to make. I didn't have anything to do with the movie financially. I was just in the book as a character. But some guy invested only $1 million, now it's almost $50 million. Shows that the issue of faith, issue of existence God, is very much in the mind of people today,
in this country. And in the book, it's very interesting. I have two parts. One part is about my coming from China, or that was actually retained in the character. This is a Chinese guy playing me there in the movie. Actually, when Hollywood cast this guy, they text me a photo. They say, "Hey Ming, here's the guy who's going to play you." And I looked at it, I said, "At least he's better looking." Actually, what I should have said, I said, "You're going to cast some guy playing me? You should recruit Brad Pitt." No, I didn't say that. But that was a year ago, and the movie was made. And so in the book, I also present some evidence after I became a believer that proving the existence of God. And they throw some of those evidences in the mouth of the main character in the movie, Joshua, in his brilliant classroom defense in front of an atheist professor about the existence of God.
In its opening weekend, the movie God's Not Dead brought in an astounding $9.2 million, making it the 10th all-time highest box office Christian movie hit. And now, in its second straight week, it continues to smash expectations and has brought in an additional $9 million. And you may not know it, but this small-budget film that's getting big national attention has a local connection. Take a look.
This semester, I propose that we refuse to waste our limited time together debating the existence of the big man in the sky. Fill in the papers I've just given you with three little words. God is dead.
I can't do what you want. I'm a Christian.
It's the story of a college student who defends God in front of his atheist professor and classmates. One of his peers he influences is a character inspired by the life of a local doctor.
The character Martin in the movie basically paralleled the life of my own. Pastor Rice actually texted me with a photo of Martin, and he said, "Okay, Ming, here's the guy who's going to play you." And I replied, I said, "Oh, at least he's better looking."
What happens in Martin's heart is something Dr. Wang remembers well.
So I grew up in China as atheist and during what they call Cultural Revolution. From 1966 to 1976, communist government decided the best way to govern is to destroy the future of all of these young people.
His fate was a lifetime of hard labor and poverty, but a chance meeting with an American professor changed everything.
In 1982, with $50 borrowed from him, with enough money borrowed from relatives, that enough for one-way airfare, that I was dropped at National Airport, Washington, D.C., with that $50, with a Chinese-English dictionary, but with a big American dream in my heart.
Ming worked hard and eventually was accepted into Harvard. There, a Christian professor took an opportunity to influence him.
He took me out for lunch, and he said, "Ming, what's across the street?" I said, "That's a car." He said, "What's the difference between car and human brain?" I said, "Human brain is a lot more complicated." He said, "Okay, can you imagine a pile of random piece of metal assemble itself into a car?" I said, "No way." He said, "How about human brain?" So right then and then, he opened a window in my life.
I think of Jesus as my friend.
You think Jesus is God.
I saw the truth and began to open myself to faith. And same thing happened to Martin that opened himself. And there's some overlap of Joshua's character with me in the book as well. In a sense, the evidence that I talk about in the book, supporting the existence of God, these evidence, the words were put into the mouth of Joshua, and he was the one who actually voiced and present this evidence.
Dr. Wang says he finally figured out that science and faith work hand in hand.
Science is about what things are, and faith is about why things are. And finally, I want to show you just how science and faith carried us in our lives. And this is our most recent foundation patient story.
De la 7 ani am ajuns la școală și când am ajuns cu problemele de vedere, îmi părea că o să fie totul închis, nu o să am prieteni, dar totul s-a ales prin puterea lui Dumnezeu.
The summer of 2012, my husband and I were fortunate to be able to take our family ourselves and our children to Moldova on a missions trip. And we found out about Moldova by attending Rolling Hills Community Church in Franklin. And they partner with a nonprofit organization called Justice and Mercy International. And I don't know when it actually was, but it was one particular Sunday, and my husband and I just looked at each other after watching kind of a clip or a video of this, and we just said, you know, we've got to do this. We've got to take our kids, and we've got to go.
We knew that, you know, we were just a couple of ordinary people that were going to serve an extraordinary God, and a God that really loves the homeless, the helpless, the sightless, the fatherless. And so we were just going to go and be the hands and feet and the heart of God. And we didn't really know what the outcome of that would be. But when we got there, we really did connect with a couple of kids. And of course, Maria was one of them.
And our goal was to work at a summer camp for children that the majority of them are orphans. We walk into camp and all of a sudden there's this beautiful girl sitting there on a bench all by herself. She just looked so sad, so lonely, and her head was down and nobody was around her. And so I went up to her with a translator, and I said, hi, you know, I introduced myself, and she told me that her name was Maria, but that's all, you know, I could pretty much get out of her. She wouldn't look up at me, and I said, Maria, let me see your beautiful face. Let me see you. I want to see you. And she looked up at me. And it was then that I realized that she had something just terribly wrong with her eyesight. I could tell. She told me that she hadn't seen her mother in about 9 years. And she was pretty pitiful. She broke my heart, I will have to admit.
And on that last day, particularly with Maria, Lynn, and Casey, they were just like attached to Maria the whole time. I mean, hugging each other, and Maria, I think, sensed that we'd be gone after that, and you know, she didn't know what would become of us after that. So we told her that we would, you know, not forget about her.
There were a lot of tears and a lot of, I think, uncertainties in her eyes and in, you know, in our hearts and minds too. And, you know, if we could have taken her back with us, then we would have, you know, but obviously we couldn't.
And so we came back to the United States and right away got in touch with the sponsorship coordinator for JMI and said, we want to sponsor Maria.
După ce am revenit din nou la școală, directoarea mi-a spus că eu totuși mă vor ajuta cu ochii și voi pleca în America.
In the congregation was a man and his wife and their partners at Rolling Hills as well, and he was moved to tears, just very, very compelled to help, to do whatever he could to help us help Maria with getting her eyes examined. And so he went straight to his eye doctor, and then his eye doctor was able to put him in touch with Dr. Wang, and then eventually got us in touch with Dr. Wang.
Maria's story really moved us because not only because her own disability, you know, that at the young age of 15 that she's blind, she couldn't see, but her spirit also moved us because she was the orphan in the orphanage who was most willing to help other orphans with misfortune and problems. So that despite her own disability, she was willing to always be lending a helping hand to other orphans. So we thought there was a child that, or teenager really, that we would like to help. So our foundation, Wang Foundation for Sight Restoration, took Maria Pong as our patient.
When we found out that it was a definite that they were coming, like within 3 days, that's about how much notice we had that it was definitely going to happen. My husband emailed Dr. Wang, and I thought to myself, you know, he hasn't heard from us in so many months, and I wonder if he'll even remember. I wonder if he'll even respond. And I'm not kidding when I say this, within an hour of my husband's email to him, we had a response back from Dr. Wang, showing us, telling us how excited he was to hear this news and that he is ready and willing and just ready to go. When we get her here, let's get her in and let's get this child evaluated.
A year after Eyeball 2012, that when we first heard about Maria, Maria walked into, came to the United States and walked into our OneVision 3D cataract and LASIK center. And I examined Maria and I realized that her left eye was completely gone, no possibility of sight, had a retinal detachment and no one did any surgery to restore sight. So she is no light perception in the left eye. For her right eye, she has maybe 1% or 2% of sight. She could see light. So it's called light perception vision. We sat down and I plotted out the whole sight restoration surgical plan and involved 10 different steps. Each of steps can have two possible outcomes, success or failure. And we can only get to the next step if the previous step is perfect or successful. So I was telling one of my colleagues that day that it was like you're throwing up a coin, you land it, and it has to be heads in order to be able to allow to throw the coin again. So what's the chance of throwing coins 10 times all in succession all come out with heads? I know that that's a very small possibility for humans, but God is powerful. Guess what? It happened. God created a miracle. The surgery went beautifully. I was able to pull the iris off the lens surface without damaging the lens surface, the capsule. I was describing this to a fellow doctor. This is like if you take two pieces of saran wrap, stick them together, glue them together, and then you take a blade in between these two pieces of saran wrap and try to cut it through all the way, separate the two pieces of saran wrap without piercing through either of the saran wrap. It's very, very difficult and it's nearly impossible. But impossible things happen today. After surgery, we all gathered around Maria and I did not know, you know, whether God will truly make her see. Even though surgery went well, but there could be intraocular structure, retina could be scarred, or optic nerve could be damaged. We could not tell, determine all of these before surgery because we could not see those structures. So, excited by this possibility, I put my hands in front of Maria. I said, "Can you see my hand moving?" And she said, "Yes." The whole room full of people, everybody, myself, we all broke into a big celebration and laughter and joy. Because we know that we're witnessing a miracle. You know, few of us as human beings have the experience of knowing someone in our lives who came out of darkness to light after many, many years, in this case 15 years. But even fewer of us will have the opportunity to be there at that moment when someone comes out of darkness into light.
Every day is just a trusting God to continue to bring healing to this child's eye, to strengthen it, and to bring her to a place where, you know, she can live and she can function, and ultimately that she can know that her God, who created her and made her, has an amazing plan, an amazing purpose for her life. And we're just, you know, Steve and I and Craig and Casey are just humbled and we're just in awe of God. And why would he choose us to be a part of this? I don't know. But we're glad he did.
You know, very often I get a question that people ask me, Dr. Wang, why you work so hard? Why you work on these charity cases, this research, trying to help patients? And we have helped many patients. Our foundation to date has helped patients from over 40 states and 55 countries with all site restoration surgeries performed free of charge. So why I want to do that? And that magical moment, that emotion, the ability to be part of that magical life transforming moment, such as Maria, open the patch, can see after 15 years, from darkness to light. I think that kind of moment is priceless. That moment is what we live for. That's a moment that reveals the true power of God. And the appreciation of the opportunity to study and go to school in this country, and the appreciation of the opportunity to experience God's power in such a rare moment of seeing someone coming out of darkness into the light, is what motivates me, and that's what drives me to work hard, to continue to do what I can do to help others to see.
Bucur foarte mult că am venit aici, fiindcă datorită Domnului și datorită doctorului Wang, eu acum pot vedea, acum am posibilitatea să văd. Am posibilitatea să văd ceea ce nu am văzut niciodată. Am posibilitatea să mă simt așa cum nu mă simțeam niciodată. Aș mulțumesc foarte mult doctorului Wang. Pentru aceasta, eu aș vrea totuși să știu.
I see Maria. Oh, careful.
Did you
see Casey? Look at Casey.
Can you see me?
Yeah.
Where's Maria? Look at her.
So we will send this video to you.
If you don't mind, forward to friends, because what we find that we have doctors stand by to help blind orphans. We have many orphans need help, but what we're missing is the middle. We need more Steve and Lynn. This is a story as much as about Maria, it's about the couple, Steve and Lynn. And they are the ones who step up, commit their lives to this child. So by forwarding this video to more people, we hopefully will come up, encounter more Steve and Lynn, who will fill in the missing link between doctors and the patients. So we'll send this video to you. I appreciate you forwarding that to friends. So in conclusion, I'm delighted to have the opportunity to share with you all today my life story about life is what you make of it. And from Cultural Revolution, the deprivation of freedom choice, and struggle with playing Chinese violin and trying to avoid deportation, a lifetime of poverty, and learning dancing, music composition, or even secretive study medicine illegally, to be able to meet this American professor who helped me and grabbed the opportunity and benefited from the teachers, parents who love me and care. And they're wiser. They've been there, they have suffered. To this country, realizing how precious opportunity is. to do what I can to help America through charity foundation. But most important to realize that at the end of the day is God who guides our lives. And he's the one who gives our lives, and he's the one empower what we do, work through each one of us, and create his miracles.